large international consulting firms that actually aren't very nice people. So I decided I didn't want to be writing reports justifying people doing bad environmental things. So I went out on my own as a self-employed consultant, mostly working in the area of waste. So I've been working in the area of waste now for at least 15 years, sort of in councils and sort of central government and consulting firms and everything else. But also a lot as an activist. I've been an activist since I was about 19 years old, in all sorts of different causes, from environmental, animal rights, social justice. I've been in unions. I've sort of really, you know, constantly just causing trouble. And now that I'm self-employed and I don't have to worry at all about whether I offend anyone, I'll be having a lot more fun. Because when you're an activist, as most activists will know, if you're working for an organisation, there's always this problem with funding and contracts and things like that. So, you know, you're working for someone and then you say something a little bit too kind of cutting edge, and then your funders say to you, "Oh, you can't say that. We're not very happy about you saying this. It's a bit extreme. That might be too radical. You need to tone that down." So when you're working for an organisation, you're always sort of pulling back a little bit from saying the things that really need to be said, because you might upset industry. So I don't have any problems with saying things that upset industry. I've made a bit of a career out of it now. Because most environmental problems that we come across are actually caused by waste that is being managed inappropriately. There are very few environmental problems that don't result from that, whether it's pollution in the oceans and the plastic in the oceans, whether it's contaminated land, which is hazardous waste, whether it's cow poo sort of going down our rivers. In most cases, what we're looking at is that we're not dealing with things at the end of life, and then they cause problems in our environment. So if we deal with our waste properly, we'll actually kind of sort out most environmental problems pretty quickly. These sorts of images people have seen all the time. I don't know if you, when I'm on my Facebook feed, I'm constantly bombarded with images of, you know, polluted rivers and streams and waste where it shouldn't be, and, you know, birds covered in oil and whales dying with plastic bags in their guts and all of that kind of stuff. And, you know, it's, can I go get that to work? There we go, it's overwhelming. So I get really quite depressed as an environmental activist, and there's a real problem amongst activists and burnout, in that you get overwhelmed hearing about all the really, really bad stuff that's happening in the world, and you sit there and you go, what can I do about it? And you sort of start to go, it's too much, it's far too big for any one person to deal with. And it's a problem. I look at my children, who are like 19 and 20 and 15, and everything, and they sort of go, well, the world's just fuck. You know, there's nothing we can do. You know, it's a climate change is coming, we're all going to die anyway. And I find that quite worrying that people would sit there and be that depressed, because actually there is things that we can do, there are things that we can do to stop all of this. But the people who are profiting from it don't want us to do those things. So they make sure that we don't hear about it. Basically, it's all your fault, is the main message that we get from profiteers, the main message we get from industry and our media and everything else. It's your fault that the whole planet is in the mess that's in. So I've been going and doing these talks now to tell you that it's not your fault. Okay? We're told over and over again that we have consumer power, that we have consumer choice, that if we make lots and lots of small, little, personal decisions, that will change the planet in some big way. If we just buy an LED light bulb, get a Prius, you know, buy, you know, unbleached cloth clothing, you know, I've got these nice shoes here made of wool, you know, all birds. If we just buy the right products, we can consume our way to environmental sanity. That's all it is. You just have to stop buying the bad products and start buying the good products, and the whole world will be rosy. It'll be lovely, won't it? This is wonderful. We're told this over and over again, that we have all the power. And I'm sure that you guys do this sort of stuff too. You know, we recycle. We use the soft plastic scheme, which is a greenwash. We go vegan, which is a great idea, by the way, totally support veganism. Okay? And you buy light bulbs, you know, get electric cars, we don't drop litter, we do all of these things. Yeah, and I'm assuming that everyone here in this room is doing something, because you're here today at Go Eco and you care. And so you want to do things. And we're really sold this whole idea of individual responsibility, that we all need to personally take responsibility for our individual actions. Again, it's that every little drop into the bucket adding up to a whole ocean of change or something along those lines. But the concept of individual responsibility came about in the 15th century. About the time when they developed this idea that the body is a machine, that in fact, you know, we are just cogs and wheels and we can change bits. Prior to this idea coming in, people actually felt that they were part of nature, that they were at one with the world. And they made decisions based on things like the seasons or their own bodily cycles. They made decisions based on what time of the month it was, what state the moon was in. This was all labelled as magic. It was all labelled as magic because it was really bad. Because if somebody wants you to get up in the morning, no matter what time of year it is, and go to a factory and stay there for 10 hours working at repetitive manual labour and then going home, then they don't like it if you get up one morning and go, well, actually it's the full moon and I've got my period and I actually really think that what I need to do is stay home and have soup. Okay, that just doesn't work with industrialization. So they had to bring in this whole idea that the body is a machine, that any kind of acknowledgement of the cycles of our planet were wrong. That's magic, that's bad. Okay, you are a machine. It is all about your willpower. It is about your work ethic. That's what you should be doing, because that's actually really good for making profits for me. So I want you all to stop thinking about this, and I want you to have individual responsibility for your decisions. Okay, so it's not that you're sick, it's not that the seasons are wrong, it's not that it's winter and you don't really want to get up at 5 a.m. Okay, it's that you just lack willpower and you need to change. So these two myths of individual responsibility and consumer power have come together in today's world to give us this idea that, you know, everything is your fault. So if you are looking at all the problems of the planet and the pollution and everything else, it's because you didn't make the right consumer choices. You didn't use your willpower to make sure that you got the right thing. It doesn't matter if you can't afford the premium that we're going to put on any sort of environmental products. That's irrelevant. Okay, it's still your choice, your decision. If you're poor, it's your fault too. Okay, it doesn't matter where you were born or who you were born to or anything else. It doesn't matter that all the research shows that people who are wealthy because of luck. They're not wealthy because of hard work. Okay, none of that's important, because what capitalism has to convince you of is individual responsibility and consumer power. Because while you're doing that, you're not actually noticing who does have the power. So if I'm sort of going to my children and I say to them, would you like a piece of apple or a piece of carrot? And my children say, I want chocolate. And I go, no, 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 those aren't the options. You can have a piece of apple or a piece of carrot. And they reluctantly choose the apple. And I go, look, most children prefer apple. They used consumer choice, so we're going to buy more apples now, because that's what they've chosen. But they're still sitting there, actually, I really want chocolate. You know? And then they say that it's all about consumer power. That's what it's like. When I go into, say, a dairy, and I'm going to buy myself a beverage, you know, I want a drink, I'm thirsty. And I go in there and I go, what would I like? I'd actually really like a low-sugar drink that comes in packaging that is not just fully recyclable, but it's actually in a washable, reusable bottle that we collected and taken away, washed and come back as being the most energy-efficient way of doing things, okay, the most environmentally friendly. And I go into the dairy and I stand there, I can get the aluminium one, I can get the plastic one, or that plastic one, or a Tetra Pak, or I can get this thin glass one. And yes, some of them might be recyclable if I happen to be close to my home recycling bin. Okay, but I'm not actually getting what I want. And over again, people have asked for bottle deposit schemes to be in place so that we can have washable, reusable glass bottles. Every survey ever has shown that people want that. If I have consumer power, and the other 85% of New Zealanders who have indicated that they want that too have consumer power, why don't we have it? If consumer power actually worked, we would not be in the state that we're in with our environment. Because for many, many years, consumers have been demanding less packaging. They've been demanding recyclable products. They've been demanding a fairer distribution of wealth. They've been demanding changes to the products that we are provided. Repairable phones, repairable computers, repairable cars, longer lifespans. And yet we don't have any of that, do we? None of it's there because consumer power is a myth. Your consumer power is about choosing amongst the products that are most profitable for them to offer you. So you get to choose between an apple and a carrot, but you don't get to choose chocolate. When they bring in supposedly green products, two things tend to happen. It might be a greenwash, and that'll be a very small incremental improvement on the environment. Not the substantial improvements that we actually want, but a small incremental one that doesn't impact on profit. Or alternatively, they will put a price premium on it. Whether the product actually costs more or not, they will put a premium on it because there's a consumer demand for it. And that means that really only people who can afford environmentally friendly products can choose the option for an environmentally friendly product. While the masses of poor people are unable to choose those options, we will never actually get a worldwide significant change. You know, if you've got most of your people struggling to put food on the table at all, you can't expect them to pay extra for organic food, for example. Okay? So we don't need to be doing any of that. We could actually change the whole system so that the environmentally friendly products are the most accessible, the most available, and the cheapest. There's no reason why we can't do that, other than that if there's a consumer demand, that's an opportunity for greater profit. So let's just sort of put this into a bit of perspective. Everyone does have personal responsibility. Okay, so I'm standing there with an empty beverage container in my hand, I have the choice of dropping it or not, don't I? Okay, I can make that choice. But there's a whole lot of other things that are going on here. Whether or not councils have put a litter bin anywhere near me. Okay, if there's nowhere for me to put the beverage container for it to be disposed of, then that's going to impact my choice of whether I drop it or not, isn't it? So while I do have some personal responsibility, I share that responsibility a little bit with council and with other regulators as to what's available for me to choose from. So we both have some responsibility. But the ones who have the biggest responsibility are the people who actually produce the products themselves. They're the ones who choose what material it's made out of. Is it recyclable? Is it compostable? Is it home compostable? Is it biodegradable? Is it reusable? Is it recyclable? They choose all of these things. Who here's got an iPhone? You want an iPhone? Okay, so Apple actually consciously make their phones to be not repairable. And not sort of not very recyclable either. So you've got these companies that choose these sorts of things. So like for example, in America they've got the digital right to repair movement and the vehicle right to repair movement. American farmers can spend like $400,000 on a tractor and they're not allowed to repair it if anything goes wrong with it. Okay. They do have licensed repairers that they can get to come in at great cost to repair their tractor. But they can't repair it themselves, they can't buy parts, they can't get a manual. And this is the same for many, many electronic goods. First of all, they make them with designed obsolescence, which means they break when they just after they come out of the warranty. And then they make it that you can't buy the parts to repair them, and they make it that you can't reuse them at all. You can't get manuals or anything like that. Because of course if something breaks and you can't fix it, buy another one, aren't you? And this is how capitalism works. It's all about continuing to consume and continuing to purchase. So the producers are actually the ones that have the greatest responsibility. They could very easily redesign all of their products so we don't have a waste problem, so we don't have a pollution problem. They could redesign their products so that we use less energy, so that we don't overproduce. You could actually have a phone that's perfectly workable that lasts for 10 years instead of 1 year. I don't know, I can't even tell you how many can openers I've been through in the last 2 years, because they seem to design them to only last 3 months before they break. It's a can opener. Okay, I remember the very first can opener I bought. I remember it because I had it for 20 years, okay? But now I can't seem to find one that lasts more than 3 months, because they want me to buy another one. And then I'm like, what do I do with my can opener? And with my can opener, because now when you buy one, they're almost always composite materials, plastic and metal together, okay, which makes it much harder to recycle. if they took responsibility for the products that they produced, they would very, very quickly start designing things that were very easy and cheap to recycle. They would start making things that were repairable if they were responsible for the end of life. But by making you responsible and telling you that it's all your fault and your responsibility to deal with it, they just abscond from any responsibility themselves. And the classic example of that is our bottle deposits. I was the coordinator last year of the Kiwi Bottle Drive, which is a campaign to bring back bottle deposits. Now, bottle deposits were that, you know, beverages used to be in recyclable packaging. Who remembers them? Hands up if you remember bottle deposits. And you would get, you pay a deposit when you bought something, and when you took the packaging back, you would get your 10 cents or whatever back. And the industry was responsible for that whole scheme. And when they moved to single-use, one-way packaging for their beverages, the public were not happy. They did not do that from consumer demand. Consumers opposed it. And every survey ever done since then shows that consumers would still prefer to drink out of glass rather than drinking out of plastic. Okay, so if consumer choice is not at play here, why did they do it? They did it because it was more profitable to go to single use. And then when we started having really big problems with waste disposal materials at the end of that, they pressured councils to bring in curbside recycling. So now councils are lumbered with this very expensive thing called curbside recycling, which is basically us as ratepayers paying for the disposal of the end-of-life products that these people specifically designed themselves to not take responsibility for. Okay, but we're paying for it. And now we have this problem with China not wanting to take those recyclable materials, and so we will have to pay more. Why can't they just change their packaging? Why can't they just go back to something that's fully recoverable and washable and reusable and recyclable? Why are we paying for that? And worse, why are we blaming ourselves for it? We didn't make any of these decisions. They made those decisions to increase their profits. It reminds me a little bit of a book by Ben Elton called This Other Eden. Has anyone read it? Great book, really recommend it. It's got this fantastic scene in it where this almost, you know, worldwide environmental collapse. The planet's in a really bad state. It's about to just, you know, go belly up. And then all of these CEOs get together and they're sitting around the boardroom crying tears into their lattes. It's terrible. It's terrible. The polar bears are all dying. What can we do? If only consumers would stop buying our products and demanding environmentally friendly ones, we could save the planet. But we can't do that. Oh no, it's all so bad. And that's pretty much what it's like. These are all CEOs. Photos of them crying crocodile tears as they admit to environmental disasters that their companies have engineered. This guy, BP CEO, testifying on the Gull oil disaster in Mexico. And all of these CEOs are doing that. They're crying crocodile tears about how, you know, it's not their company's fault. If only the consumer would use their consumer power and choose environmentally friendly products. Every one of these CEOs could, in a moment, pass an order that makes their products not environmentally harmful. The reason they don't is because of profits. They are responsible to their shareholders to make profits. They're not responsible to the planet. They're not responsible to people. They're not responsible to society. The only thing they exist for is to make a profit. They are, in fact, profiteers. A profiteer is somebody who makes an excessive profit at the expense of people or the planet. So we're not talking about people like my brother, who's a bricklayer. You know, he hires about 10 people and he builds things. Okay, he's not making excessive profits. He still has mortgage. He treats his work as well. He's not damaging the environment. Okay, so your average business is not a profiteer. What we're talking about is the likes of BP and Shell and Monsanto and Bayer and all of those other corporations doing things that we know are harmful to people and the planet. And they're getting away from it and they're making enormous excessive profits. And we're allowing them to do that. Because, sort of a bit like domestic violence victims, we are blaming ourselves for the abuse that the profiteers are meting out to us. We're sitting there going, it's all my fault, I didn't buy the LED light bulb. And this is because fundamentally, capitalism, as our socio-economic system, is designed to do this. Okay, capitalism is based on the bizarre idea that we can have infinite growth in a finite environment. Okay, our planet has finite resources. Capitalism is a system that is designed to have infinite growth, infinite profit growth, infinite resource collection, infinite production, overproduction, in fact. And the only way they're able to continue with this myth is by convincing you that it's all your fault. It's all about individual responsibility, not corporate responsibility. We actually must end capitalism, because if you grow and grow and grow, you eventually hit, you know, the ends of your planetary resources, and we can't go past that. It's like a you know, whatever you wore when you were five, you can't still wear it now. You've outgrown it. We actually have to move to a completely different socioeconomic system. We need system change, not climate change. And basically, the difference you got here is we need to move away from unlimited growth, and we need to move to the idea that we stay in equilibrium with our environment. We need to, you know, move away from overproduction, which is what capitalism does. We produce much more than we need. Anyone has gone to a mall recently or a $2 shop, and you look around and you go, did we need to make any of that? That's overproduction. So we need to actually move to a system where we only produce what we need, and we limit that so that we can protect and nurture our resources. Capitalism works unconsciously and automatically to funnel wealth upwards, okay? It's designed that way. It's designed to accumulate wealth. Capitalism is policies and systems designed to benefit those who have capital. Capital is accumulated wealth. We need to move to a system which works unconsciously and automatically against that. Something that automatically works to keep us in equilibrium with our entire society. We need to move away from this individualism and competition and move towards cooperation and societal progress, which is basically evolution. You know, our evolution success has been because of our cooperation. We're one of the most cooperative species on the planet, and we're actually quite successful because of it. In terms of what we're going to move to, we don't know yet. Basically, it took 200 years to go from feudalism to capitalism. And while we were going through the change, we didn't have a word for it. The word capitalism didn't come until much later. When we are changing from one socioeconomic system to another system, we're in transition, we're in flux. So when people say, what are we going to change to? Who knows? We haven't actually invented it yet. But these are the things that it has to have if, as a species, we want to survive. So I'd love it if somebody else came up with a good catchy word. Best I've done with is equilibrialism, which is a bit wordy. I can't go with that. So basically, what can people do? This is the thing that I'm trying to get through to people. It's not about what you buy. But you cannot buy your way out of this mess. What we actually need to do is buy less stuff. And we need to buy it less often. Well, we need to reuse things, repair things, make it yourself, share it, give it away. Okay, because production is what the problem is. We're using too many resources. So stop buying stuff unless you absolutely have to. Can you go a whole day buying nothing? Can you go a whole week buying nothing? How long can you go without buying anything? And I just want to point out here that eco-capitalism is still capitalism. Yeah, I totally support you going out and buying environmentally friendly products and all that sort of stuff. If you do have to buy something, you know, if you can afford it, make it environmentally friendly, that's great. But buying nothing is so much better. Because eco-capitalism is still capitalism. And if you're a company making a really amazing eco, you know, product, and you grow and grow and grow, well, you're growing. Okay? And endless growth is the problem. That's what we have to move away from, that whole mindset of growth. So we need to start standing up and fighting back a lot more demanding stuff. We need to actually demand that the people who produce products deal with the mess that their products are causing. We need to demand them to change what the materials they're made out of, demand that things are repairable, demand they end designed obsolescence. Making things to break in 3 months' time is just wrong. Okay, we actually need to demand that they stop doing that. We need to insist that we are not to blame. The amount of influence that we as individuals have is tiny compared to the amount of influence that the product producers have. They have the most ability to change their products, and so therefore they must take the bulk of the responsibility. So we need to fight back and demand they do that. Resist any solutions that are put up that are funded by the public. We do this all the time. You know. Oh, no, there's a great big problem with your product. Oh, government, can I have $700,000, please, to set up some greenwash recycling store? And then we pay again. It's still us paying. It's actually the people who are profiting, the profiteers, need to pay. And as we go into climate change and all of the mitigations and problems that we're going to have adapting to climate change, okay, it's not the poor people who should pay for that. Okay, it's not, they did not make the mess. The profiteers, the people who have profited from the environmental mess that we are in, are the ones who should be paying for the adaption and mitigation that we're going to need to do, the infrastructure changes. Okay, the fact that you're going to have all these coastal properties washed away. The fact that up in Auckland now we're facing an 11.5% increase in petrol prices. Okay, like I did not profit from any of the things that have been caused the problems in Auckland, but I'm paying for it. And even worse, people who are much worse off than me, who have been pushed to the outskirts of the city, are paying for it. So we actually need to demand these things. And it's not good enough to just ask nicely and say I'd like it. We actually have to stand up and fight back and demand these things. If we don't do that demanding, then we will just continue with what's happening now, because our individual consumer choices will not be sufficient to deal with climate change. That's all.